A very good evening, respected panelists and members of the audience. I heartily welcome you all for today's panel discussion. Before we go ahead, I would like to brief the audience about Confluence. Confluence is an annual international medical conference hosted and organized by St. GS Medical College and KM Hospital, Mumbai. As a part of Confluence, we are organizing panel discussions and webinars consisting of eminent guest speakers and panelists with huge experience and knowledge in their respective fields. Our goal is to bring together bright minds to give talks and discuss topics of importance that are idea-focused and solution-oriented. And with this, I would like to introduce the topic of today's panel discussion, Brain Drain, Reasons, Repercussions, and Solutions in the Era of Globalization. Human capital flight refers to the emigration or immigration of individuals who have received advanced training at home. The net benefits of human capital flight for the receiving country are referred to as brain gain, whereas the net costs for sending country are referred to as brain drain. Nearly four decades back, the idea of individuals and professionals migrating to different places worldwide in pursuit of lucrative careers and world-class education was a massive achievement for Indians. This was primarily because India simply did not have the professional prospects that other countries offered. Starting with the IT sector, this phenomenon of brain drain is being increasingly seen in the health sector as well. India is one of the largest exporters of healthcare workers to the developed world countries. Data available from 2017 by the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, shows there were 69,000 doctors from India working in the UK, US, Canada, and Australia. Migration of health workers has been held responsible for health worker shortages in low-resource settings. However, transnational mobility of health professionals is now being considered an inevitable consequence of globalization. So on this note, I would like to introduce the moderator of the panel discussion, Dr. Munira Hirkani, Associate Professor, Department of Physiology, St. GS Medical College and KM Hospital, Mumbai. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Vidushi, for introducing the topic, the panel, and myself. I welcome all the audience to this panel discussion and hope it's going to be an interesting session for you all. Let me now introduce to the audience our esteemed panelists. So the team has managed to get a variety of speakers who would give their inputs on this topic. So firstly, I have that immense honor of introducing to you all a person who requires no introduction, but I'll do the honors anyways, Dr. Tatya Rao Lahane, who is an ophthalmologist with a world record of conducting more than 1.62 lakh plus cataract surgeries. Sir has served as the Dean of Grant Medical College and Sir JJ Group of Hospitals for many years, and later he has also held the position of Director of DMER, which oversees the undergraduate, postgraduate, super speciality, medical and dental education, research, and also the overall administration of various government hospitals. Throughout the service, Sir has strived to provide healthcare to patients even in the remotest areas. Sir, we are glad you are here with us today to give your inputs on this topic, and we welcome you. The next panelist is none other than Dr. Avinash Supe. Welcome, sir. Sir has completed, as we all know, his undergraduation, post-graduation, and GI surgery training from St. GSMC and KMH. And he's a much loved teacher, a mentor. He was professor and head of GI surgery, ex-dean of Sion Hospital, and also St. GSMC and KMH, ex-director of medical education and major hospitals of MCGM Group of Hospitals. Sir is also a founder director of GSMC FAMER, a non-profit organization working with ECFMG to promote excellence in health professions education. Currently, Sir holds the post of executive director at Hinduja Healthcare. Sir has received many awards. The prestigious one is the BC Roy Award in 2018. Welcome, sir. Here, I would also like to mention that we also the first panelist that I introduced, Dr. T.P. Lahane, sir, is a Padma Shri awardee, and we are very proud to have him with us here today. Our next panelist is Dr. Puneet Bhojani, whom Dr. Puneet is a faculty and mentor of an academy. By profession, he is a gynecologist and obstetrician and an infertility specialist. Almost 15 years of experience he holds in training medical students for the various competitive exams for post-graduation. He also has to his credit, he's a founder member of an app called as Dr. Mentors for training the students. And also he has authored many books for undergraduate and postgraduate entrance exams. We welcome you, Dr. Puneet, for this panel discussion. Next, we have Dr. Akshay Falak. Dr. Akshay Falak has completed his graduation from Topiwala National Medical College and BYIL Nair Charitable Hospital, Mumbai. He has been an excellent academician. He has visited as a King Scholar to St. Thomas Hospital, London, won various national, international accolades in preclinical and clinical quizzes. Currently, he holds the post of medical officer in the pulmonary medicine department at TNMC. Of course, he has many other additions to his credits, and we will be discussing that shortly. Welcome, Dr. Akshay. We have two of our very own students from GSMC and KEMH, Dr. Aditya Vadgaonkar, who has completed his MBBS from GSMC, and he's currently pursuing PhD as a student at University of Heidelberg, Germany. I know Aditya to be a very creative person, an amateur painter, and also an entrepreneur. He has also been the chief coordinator of the Cultural Fest Avishkar at GSMC. Welcome, Aditya. And our last panelist is Dr. Devi Bavishi. Dr. Devi also has done her MBBS from GSMC. Currently, she is pursuing general surgery at University of Texas, USA. Devi herself was the organizing secretary of Confluence 2016. And we welcome you, and we are very glad to have this panel with us today. Before we begin the panel discussion, I would like to request all the audience to remain muted. We request you to put in your questions as they come to you in the chat box. We will take the questions at the end of the panel discussion, where we have kept a protected time for answering your questions. And I request the panelists to be additive to whatever has been discussed to add the points and avoid repetitions. So shall we begin this discussion? So referring to the COVID-19 pandemic, I had read somewhere in the newspapers that the Chief Justice of India, N.V. Ramana, he praised the doctors for their service. He called them heroes without capes. And he also called them living gods and goddesses, the devis. So now I would like to put my first question to Devi. Why are our healthcare workers, why are our gods and goddesses, why are our devis leaving India and moving further to other countries for pursuing training and for practicing? Over to you, Devi.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It is a great honor to share the stage with Lahane sir, Sufi sir, and my batchmates. So I just wanted to give an introduction about how many people migrate from India, just a little bit of stats. And if I'm wrong, Supe sir, Lahane sir can correct me on that numbers. So every year we have 70,000 doctors who are MBBS graduates. And out of that, 2.7% leave the country. And out of that, only 1/4 of people stay in foreign countries. So we are talking about only 0.5% people, that is 350 students every year. So just wanted to say that at the start, what is our population we're gonna talk about? The factors which are responsible for migration, I've divided into personal factors and professional factors. So professional factors are basically more education, more research. I would like to expand on education being, here I have a structured education curriculum, which is not the norm in our country. And that is one thing which I like about here. The other thing are good fellowship opportunities. There are fields which are not available in India. For example, one of my forensic medicine professor was a forensic odontologist, and then she told me that she's only one of the three forensic odontologists in the country. Because she wanted to pursue that, she went outside the country because we didn't have options to pursue that field. So similar to that, like people go outside to go into fellowships which are not available in India. The other is also because we can see diverse patient population in multiple hospital settings, unlike India, where we work only in one hospital with the patient population, which are, if it is very narrow. So this is related to education. About research, I would like to say that there's more opportunities in terms of more funding and more support. So in India, it's a requirement for professors to have a certain number of publications to be able to be promoted. But we don't have enough funding for the professors to be able to do good research. The thing is, the research gets done, but if we would have more funding, we would increase our research output to double the amount or triple the amount if we have that kind of funding and support. These are like some professional reasons. Some of the personal reasons are majorly is quality of life, which is kind of better in places outside our country. So just to give some stats, in India, the general population average life expectancy is 69 years, which is for doctors, it's 55 to 59 years, which is like 10 to 15 years lesser than the average population. But in the United States, the average life expectancy is 78 years, and the average life expectancy of doctors is 68 to 73 years, which is only like 5 to 10 years lesser than the general population. I think that it is because of factors like restricted work hours. You are able to devote more time to exercising, more family life, just spending your personal time and getting to think about different things like research, spending time with your family. Also, like when you have more quality time, you like tend to have better ideas and like better research output. So I feel that because of globalization and like world becoming a global village, people will always like to achieve more than they can. So just starting from very basic ground, in rural population, they tend to migrate to urban, like people from small towns come to Mumbai. That can also be considered a brain drain of the rural population, that which is very similar to brain drain from like bigger like towns like metro cities like Mumbai to other developed countries. So we are just trying to have a brain share, as Vidushi talked about, instead of thinking it as brain drain.
Very nice thought about brain drain from rural to urban areas and the concept of brain share. I was just thinking, you talked about education, you talked about research, the funding. So is opportunities for funding greater in other countries as compared to India? Or is the magnitude or the quantity higher?
I would believe both of them, because in India, we do have grants, but not many people are aware about it, first thing. And the amount is not enough to be able to get more people involved into research. So if someone wants to do outcomes research, we need to have people who can collect data, who can analyze data. But in India, it's all the PI who does all of this. But in like other countries, we have special people like statisticians, data collectors, clinical research coordinator to do all of this job. So it's more, the PI can focus more on writing and like analyzing the project instead of like devoting his time to other things.
Thanks, Devi. Let's hear from Dr. Aditya. Dr. Aditya, you've just moved to Germany. And can you share with us what do you think are the key factors which influence this decision of students to move to different countries to pursue their studies? Aditya, you're not audible.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Okay, I think there's a problem with my microphone. Yeah. Before I begin, I have to say that it is indeed an honor to be here as an alumnus of the college for the very first time before an audience and sharing the stage with Supe sir, with Lahane sir, Mujani sir, and my colleague Devi, and with you, ma'am. I tried changing the background, but unfortunately that's not working. So I'm guessing you're going to have to look at me with this background. To answer your question, ma'am, I would actually like to tell you a story that happened with me in last year in 2020, when I was an elective student at the University of Oxford. I was peacefully having my lunch in a corner when I saw a group of people pour into the room, and they were visibly excited. There was exhilaration, and that was palpable. So I knew that there was something happening, and I was curious to find out what. I recognized some of them as fellow interns on the surgical ward that I was working on. So I walked over to them to ask them what's going on. "We're going on a week-long trip," they said, "to Spain." And I was a little bit confused, since I knew that two of them were rotating with me and they were supposed to be on the emerge duty in the surgical ward the next day. Now, my confusion turned into annoyance when I realized that two of my colleagues are going to be missing on the emerge day. But this annoyance was soon replaced by curiosity. I was curious about how are they able to do this? How are they allowed to do something like this? And when I asked them about it, their answer was very simple. They said that they were entitled to 5 weeks of annual vacation. Now, this is a stark contrast from my internship in India, during which I was supposed to have only 12 annual days of leave. And for those of you in the audience who've gone through this or are in it at the moment, you probably know how hard it is to get your reg and your HOU to approve even one day of CL, and try asking that on an emerge day, and you are, I guarantee you that you're going to get a look as if you've asked them for both their kidneys. It's definitely, it's a no-go. Absolutely not. Now, you're probably wondering, why is it that I'm telling you this story when we are here talking about the brain drain problem in India? Well, it's pretty obvious, isn't it? These disparities in the working conditions between India and other countries is what is a great pull for Indians towards more developed countries. And this is exactly what my colleague Devi spoke about earlier. Also, in India, healthcare and other professionals are often not paid enough to be able to maintain what they consider a respectable standard of life. Now, by this, I mean stuff like better housing, good schools for their children, ownership of a car, and so on. Now, the cost of living has gone up considerably high. Now, I was beyond surprised to find out that the cost of petrol today in Mumbai is more than 100 rupees per liter. It was less when I left the country, but I was absolutely surprised that it's more than 100. Now, the inventory of things regarded as essential for a comfortable lifestyle has also increased, and with it, the minimum required salary to sustain such a lifestyle. The income that a highly skilled professional can earn in a Western country could be anything like 4 to 5 times that he would be earning in India. And this massive economic leap and more lucrative opportunities in other countries is a major factor that drives people to abroad. Access to better education and research opportunities is also a big reason. And this is something that Devi already spoke about, so I'm just going to mention it briefly. Now, these factors that I mentioned above are categorized as the pull factors, meaning that there are favorable conditions in other countries that are inviting to Indians. However, there are also a number of push factors, which are adverse conditions in India, which promote people to undertake this transcontinental journey in search of a better life. So to give you an example, in the year 2020, 160,888 candidates, including myself, took part in the NEET PG exam. They were competing for less than 24,000 seats across the nation. Now, if you consider the most sought after seats in the top few branches that people really want to work in, the selection ratio would be less than 3%. This means that less than 1 in 33 qualified MBBS doctors are going to get a PG seat of their choice. And here we are not even considering a college of their choice. What is this if not cutthroat competition? And these ratios are made even worse by the fact that more than half of the seats are not even open to the general population. Now, I do sincerely believe that reservation is an attempt at giving equal opportunity to everyone. And I do see the merit in it. But that does not take away from the fact that it makes the already existing brutal competition even more extreme. So it's this interplay of push and pull factors, in my opinion, that kind of influence the migration of people outside of India, not just to the United States or a country in particular, but all countries across the world. However, contrary to what people believe, it is not all bad. The concept of brain drain is rather used indiscriminately by many and has like emotive and pejorative connotation. So just like Shah Rukh Khan says in the movie, My Name is Khan, I think that I need to give this disclaimer. My name is Aditya. I study in Germany, but I do not hate India. Because there exists this general notion that if somebody leaves the country, they do so because they hate their country and they're ashamed of it. I'm actually quite the opposite. I'm a proud Indian who still very much eats Indian food, celebrates Indian festivals, and has not anglicized his name to Adi. I still go by the name Aditya. I do not think that I'm doing any disservice to my country by moving outside. So if you think about the IFS cadre, which is the most sought after in the country, it's a group of people who live outside the country and they do more for the country than most of us will ever do. So instead of looking at migration of people outside of India as a problem that we need to stop, I urge you to look at it differently. And we need to look at it as, you know, as an advantage to the country, which is what I would be talking about in the later round. But here is how I sum up. These push factors and pull factors are what influence the migration of students outside of India.
Thanks, Devi and Aditya, for bringing out these various factors. So Devi talked about all the luring her to the other countries, about research, about education opportunities. And you talked about factors like limited seats for post-graduation. You talked about factors like which affect that availability of those limited seats. And now I also want to hear from the other panelists. What do you think are any of these reasons that Devi and Aditya mentioned? You want to like to add on to those reasons? You want to ask clarifying questions? Or you have any inputs to give? It's open for you to the panelists. Dr. Supe, Dr. Lane, you have any other inputs to give about these reasons?
Because Lane, sir, you want to speak before? Bola, sir.
Welcome, Supe, sir. Basically, both they have put their views. The Aditya, who is not in India, just now to start only with, I was discussing that the students who are meritorious, like in KEM, they go first out. And what he was saying, yes, I'm there, but I love my country. So like that, I'm very happy for that, because Singapore is doing that. In the Singapore, what they do, they are giving the scholarship and sending their engineers to the developed country, that means in America or US. And after the complete training, then they are calling them back. And then there is a bond of 5 years. What we are doing for our people here in MBBS, that after MBBS, now there is a bond of 3 years. It means 1 year, 1 year, 1 year. So like that, we can also have a scholarship like the Aditya was saying. And then those who are going out, they should, but that should be compulsory. Now what is happening, how the Devi was saying that the people, 2.7% doctors, they are leaving India every year. And out of that, not maximum people are not coming to India, returning to the India. So I think there should be something because that they should return to India. And like Aditya said, yes, we require a good education. And if that education is better in the developed country, then our students should go there, but they should come back.
So there's also thought about, solutions which are there. But let's explore some more reasons that make students
Bola, move away from. Can I say something?
Yes, sir.
I think this one topic has been discussed in detail by one Professor Mulan, who came to our institution in 2006. I don't know how many of you have listened to him. This is a person who has done extensive study about migration of people across in healthcare. He has a paper in 2006, which you should really read. Now, what he said, very interesting paper. He, that time, India had about 40,000 MBBS seats. And that time, 8,000 students used to migrate. across from India per year, and 2,000 used to go to USA. Now, and other 6,000 used to go to other countries like Singapore, UK, Australia, Sri Lanka, and all other places. And this is what is a kind of a platform. But today, we have 1 lakh students, which are almost 80,000 plus 20,000 students come from Russia and all. So we have a huge number of doctors are available. But still about 10,000 people migrate. Actually, Devi, it's not 2.3%. It's much about more. You know, about say 15% or 16% people go to the abroad, but only 2%, 3% go to USA. Now, the whole concept is, once the Mulan said, there are, so the, when you say brain drain, it is that the educated people are going either to a developing country, developed country, or internal brain drain. You know, people are shifting to the management, somebody is going in security. Now, person who is trained as a medical doctor ultimately goes somewhere else. All that things happen. And I think you rightly said, people have said, it's all about pull and push factors. Now, people always feel the grass is greener on the west, you know, but remember, grass is greener where we water it or we really cultivate it, you know. So we have to cultivate good practice in our country. And that's what I feel is a big problem. So all the points they said, lack of opportunities, political instability, economic depression, poor infrastructure, less research facilities, corruption, all this is true. But remember, when you go abroad, now probably I must have seen 30 countries' health systems, visited them and learned also in US. But I realize their system also has their own issues. So once you're going from here to here, you know, we have to be very clear that if I stay in India, I will have these kind of problems I'll have to work. But there's always a place on the top. I've seen so many of our students doing very well. But when people go there, those few percent of people, they are very focused. And many of them are very focused, but they don't get that focused job there. Very few get jobs there what they want. Aditya talked about getting a choices seat. How many people who go to USA get their choices institution and choices seat? But they accept anything in any hospital. But probably they feel the uniformity is there in their education. It is not so. Remember, Mayo Clinic, John Hopkins, and somewhere you're working in Nevada is not the same program. But people just want to go there, get some kind of a degree, and do a local practice. So I think they are going, not going for then kind of opportunity. They are going there purely for the purposes of shifting to the West. So I think one should be very clear. There are some percentage of people who want to go there, which is fine. They can come back, they can think about brain gain, reverse brain drain, all that philosophies are okay. But one should realize that people mainly go for pull and push factors because they feel they are not likely to get it here very easily, or they are looking for a greater pastures, better income, better research grants. Fair enough. I think that's, but that probably does not affect our country. It definitely affects in terms of the ratios. These are all good quality of students who could have done better in India, but now they become the gain for the countries like US and other countries. Like, see, if you see US, currently you find every year, imagine 2000, last 50 years practice, more than 1 lakh, 2 lakh people are from US who are Indians. Prime places are there run by Indians. So we definitely give them the service. The whole question here is that, do we, can we produce more? So we are continually producing more. So what is government's policy in this? If you see Niti Aayog's policy, you have listened to Dr. Paul about 3 days ago, and his policy is that we are going to expand the number of seats, and they have rapidly increased the number of seats of postgraduate. So from 24,000, we have now at a rate of 36 to 38,000. And if you say we have 82,000 students coming out of this, and we have at least ratio of now about 30 to 40% people will get postgraduate seat. And I'm sure the situation will be better because now I think we are improving our health system also, though maybe health budgets are low. Systems in India are improving, maybe with partly private or partly government sector. So I think people are making a choice to stay in India. Not that everybody wants to go there because of their other issues. So it's a very complex problem. And it's not only pull and push, everybody has his own agenda. It's not that people are pushed like that. You know, it's like people make a choice to go there and learn to, I mean, they...
Kindly mute the audience. No problem. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for sharing. Yes, Dr. Puneet.
Yeah, first of all, absolute honor to share the stage with Dr. Lahane sir and Supe sir. Madam, you've introduced me, but one thing is that I'm also from GS Medical College, done my gynecology under the guidance of Dr. Vinita Salvi. And that time, Supe sir was our dean and absolute privilege. So absolutely well summarized by sir that push and pull. And the important point is that, yes, getting a seat of your choice is difficult in India, but it's equally difficult in US also. Because many of my colleagues have migrated. The majority of them are in geriatric medicine or public health. And very few of them get a gynec or a surgical dermat. So those all fields. So definitely majority are doing only a general medicine or a geriatric medicine. So getting a choice of a seat in US itself is also very difficult of your choice. And the solution, yes, sir, I said that seats are increasing and we should try to increase the seats in India to partly resolve the problem. And one more push factor, which also we, I'm sure all of us are working on it, is a point we should like to bring out is the violence against doctors. So the laws are very strict in USA, UK, where you cannot just get away with it. So we doctors have, we go on protest lots of times, we try our best. And yes, things are improving, but more stricter action if taken, that will also really help us.
No, that's a very good point, actually, what you said about fear of working environment, you know, fear of working environment. I think that is something which is there. But remember, Puneet, I had really done a survey and I talked on one side. I realized that hitting a doctor is common in most of the countries. The incidences may be less or more, but even in US also, they have reported a fairly good number of incidences of hitting a health worker. But as you said, the environment is much better to work there than the other departments. I think that's a very important point you made.
I think we have discussed a lot of things about the factors which make the students migrate. But what is the problem that occurs because the students migrate? That is what I want to ask Dr. Supe and Dr. Lahane, who have been working in administration and who are working at the grassroots levels. Lahane sir is working to improve the healthcare. So because of this migration, sir, can you just share with us your thoughts of what are the problems occurring in India?
Sure. See, it's like underdeveloped countries are spending millions of rupees of training in these experts, like say MBBS level. See, America doesn't spend the money onto the undergraduate teaching. They take all ready-made doctors from our country. Now, you know, see, America had, you know, very classic example. You should read one paper in American College of Surgeons. About, say, 8 years ago, they used to have 24,000 residency seats. 17,000 was their undergraduate capacity. 8,000 people they used to get from all over the world. Out of that, 2,000 were Indian. Over a period of time, you know Flexner's report and how they stopped the number of medical colleges. In 2008 or 10, they opened new more medical colleges. And now their seat is going to be 24,000, but their residency requirement has gone to 32,000. So 8,000 seats they are anyway going to require. So the first thing India really faces is we are putting all our resources, we are making our patients use, and we are giving the ready-made product to them. So we are losing at our point. That is one major implications of brain drain to us.
Dr. Lahane, I would just also like to listen from Dr. Lahane, what is happening at the healthcare level?
See, in the healthcare level, as you know, as Supe sir and all the panelists are, I think they are put forward the things. The healthcare level also, if you see the number of the doctors or number of the nurses, and you compare with the, you can say the WHO or anything. So in India, we are having only 1.5 nurses per 1,000 people. So what is requirement by WHO? It is 3. Minimum 3 nurses should be there. Now, why these nurses are going? That is also a problem. Because in the private, the nurses are not paid properly. when I was in the council of the nurses, that then I asked everybody that there should be minimum 20,000 pay. They were paying 13,000 less than a, you can say, the sweeper. The same thing is happening with the doctors. You will see today our ratio of the doctor is one doctor in 1400 population. So that is what is there. And WHO said it should be one in 1100 population. Now, just now the supervisor was saying that every year, if the 2000 people are going, from 50 years, 2 lakhs, 1 lakh people has gone to minimum. You can see UK, America. It means the doctors today, what is the physician requirement of India according to the population is a minimum 13 lakhs physicians should be there. But we are having only 6 lakhs physicians. But minimum 3 to 4 lakh physicians are outside the India. And I think that they might have helped us. But that is on the health side. You can see it is the problem of the beds. You will see there are only 5 beds for the 10,000 population. That is also you can go for the ICU. It means in the, you can say the health infrastructures or in the health manpower. There is a brain drain. The people are going not only in the UK, also going in the Middle East. Nurses are maximum going in the Middle East. And the statistics says that the number of the doctors in America and the UK are crossing 2 lakhs population from India only. And I think in the health side, what is happening, you will see in the PSC, no doctor. In the rural hospital, no doctor. So today also, after so many doctors now passed, today also there are 3,000 posts vacant in Maharashtra. If you see in India, it may be more, but I'm not having statistics of India in Maharashtra. And now we are asking that all the bonded candidates, they should go and work in PSC. And when I gave the appointment to the bonded candidate compulsorily this time in COVID, I will tell you, so many PSCs out of 1950 PSC, they saw the doctor first time. The PSC was established 10 years before. And after 10 years, they saw the doctor. So I think in the health system, the doctor's number is less, bed number is less, ICU beds are less. Also the people
nurses.
Nurses also less. So everybody, I think all these health workers, number is less. And still the people are going out. So I think we'll have to do something. This is the problem. So it is not one day we can solve it, but we can, we'll have to take some steps to solve it so that we can attract our people to come back after the education. And about the Aditya, I want to tell you, when they are going out, I will tell you, after doing MD, they are doing residency and like that. And here they will be lecturer, but they are doing residency there. About the subject, maximum people, I will tell you, the one person, my brother has gone there. He is a psychiatrist, but now he is working as a paramedics there. He's an MD psychiatrist working as a paramedics there. So it is not the subject. They are not getting the subject as choice there also, but maybe the better living conditions in India, it may not be the salary is another problem. The subject, I was also not willing to go for ophthalmology, but I was to go to pediatrics and orthopedic. But now I am in ophthalmology. So whatever the branch you are getting, you can be successful in that. So I think it depends on what is the green field you should think. If this is the green field, you can do it wonders here. But if you think that the green field is not in India, no one can change your mind. So that is what the mindset is also important.
So what I hear from Dr. Suppe and Dr. Lane is that, yes, we are producing a lot of doctors, but still there is a shortage here, even after this lot of saturation in the urban areas. The rural areas are facing a shortage. And of course, it's something like brain robbery, you can say, that we are spending the money, we are training the students, and then the developed countries are having the benefits or reaping the benefits. I want to ask Dr. Puneet now, suppose like you have been training postgraduate students for both competitive exams in India as well as the other exams. So if you have a student who's coming to you for guidance and asks your opinion as to whether he should continue his further studies and career in India or whether he should go abroad, what would be your advice and why?
So madam, now almost since 15 years I've been training students, and the numbers are out what even Aditya had pointed out, and I absolutely agree that the situation has slightly become better. Entrance exam which you will give in India is the toughest exam of your entire life. There's nothing about it. Because as rightly pointed, there are some 150,000 students give the entrance exam. And we know there are 35,000 seats, but even the last few seats would be very much remote. And then you don't want to land up between diploma in some this and this one. So yes, the situation is difficult. But as we know that it's a balanced approach, even sir has pointed out that you have to decide what is your, because grass is always appearing green on the other side is the point. And the students who have made up the mind, even I had my colleagues who were right from second year, third year, were sure we want to move to US, UK. So those who have decided, they have to start preparing in that way, and that kind of a thing. From those who are planning to stay in India, yes, we tell them, those who are migrating abroad, we can tell them the point, the advantages, disadvantages. Yes, majority points are advantages, but just a word that you may not always get a seat of your choice over there also. Getting adjusted, learning a new medical lingo over there, and even financial support. I've spoken to my friends over there. Initially, a lot of investment is required. You will recover that. But for the first few years, when you are doing a research, you are all by yourself. So financially, it's going to be an initial that to support you for the first 2-3 years.
I would just like to just add my thought here. Suppose if the postgraduate seats in India are not enough and available for a person who doesn't have reservation to pursue, then even in India, the private medical colleges, if I'm opting for, the cost of education is not less. So that also requires a lot of support. Yes. So then that's a choice between pursuing education in a private medical college in India or trying and using that money to go abroad. So you can, if you can put your thoughts on this, please.
And yeah, madam. So private seats, of course, they are very expensive over in India. Here also, we know the price goes in crores and all that. But what I'm saying is that once you see, there are two things. It's not that once you directly migrate to US or UK, you get you are joining residency on day one. So there you'll have to spend some time, 2-3 years. And if you are going abroad, be prepared to lose 1-3 years before you actually start your residency. Okay, that is one thing. And again, the choice you might have to compromise, you know, and also initially the students, they are cases that, you know, it's not that picture is always rosy, depression events, the students who feel really homesick, all these things should be considered. We don't, I as a doctor or somebody, I don't discourage anybody from doing a particular thing, but these all points should be taken out, should be informed to them. And those who are preparing in India, it's my sincere request, because your first MBBS entirely goes in just getting adjusted, but please start your PG preparation from second MBBS year itself. Okay, because the integrated study, what we do from second year, we're attending wards. Gone are the days when you start your PG preparation and internship. Those days are gone. You need to start preparing from second year onwards and read lot of medicine, surgery, gynec from second year. Start. I'm not saying you finish off. So that kind of a preparation is required. Intensive, yes, seats are very difficult. But and the one very important point of stress to students, lots of students are there, that there is no substitute for textbook reading. Today, I don't blame the students, but lots of the students, they're taking shortcuts, just interested in MCQ guides. You may get a seat, but sir will agree that reading the textbook is very important, which the students should do from second year onwards.
And also going to the wards and looking at patients.
Going to the wards, yes, when the COVID scenario, as and when, of course, now things are better. So yes, we should. So, but that, because MCQ guides, of course, you will have to do that. You have to go for rapid revision books towards your exam. But if your theoretical knowledge is sound, you can crack any exam, whether it's Indian or USMLE, because textbooks are the basis. MCQ, I always tell the students, MCQ is nothing but asking you theory only, just tweaking the question. It's just confusing the students with four options. It's nothing but your theory.
Thanks for the practical advice. Thank you so much. I'm sure the students who are listening will appreciate that tip of starting early. Dr. Akshay.
I'm sorry to interrupt there, and I kind of want to pitch in over here, borrowing the point on what Dr. Bhujani said. So I think that this in itself is the problem, right? Like, this is a big major push factor that exists for Indian students, that if I have to in my second year start preparing for an exam that is 4 years into the future, and I am studying subjects that I have not learned in my college, I mean my university lessons, but I'm still expected to learn them, then that is a huge requirement which is causing such a massive burnout for students. And I believe that a lot of people would resonate with this. And this is the problem that we are trying to, this is one of the major push factors that we are trying to say, is that encourages people to say that, okay, well, if I'm preparing for another exam to go outside of the country, it's not going to be 4 years of my life fully, entirely dedicated only for this. I'm also going to be learning a lot of other things, because there are other practical aspects of being a doctor also, which are valued. And it's not just merely solving MCQs that takes precedence over all other things.
Aditya, I think there are two things are very important at this stage. One is, the next is likely to come in 2022 or 2023. Next is probably going to have more emphasis on the clinical teaching. I think NMC is already preparing for next.
Yes.
And they're already deep into that. So maybe by next year or the year later, they will introduce next, where there will be a lot of clinical component which will be there. And secondly, when you're talking about USMLE, now see, I think all of us work for USMLE, FAMER and all. So we are deep into, I know how they do USMLEs. Now there, they definitely respect your clinical component in a deep way. So I understand preparing for 4 years is okay, but you cannot just say that I will neglect my clinical component. You know, that clinical component spent in our regular wards will give you lifelong importance. You know, I think that's something people should remember. You know, I understand you prepare yourself for some period of time for your final examinations or final NEET and all, but don't neglect your clinical ward component. That is the message I want to give you, because that will be remembered for you anywhere. Even if the exam pattern changes, you have to face USMLE, or you have your clinical patients later on in your life, that component is going to stay with you. And I think, don't neglect it.
Yeah, so we need to maintain a balance between these preparing for the competitive exams, but also retain our core skills that we have entered the course for, so that we can treat our patients to the best of our capabilities. To the audience, I would just like to share something.
I just want to echo what Dr. Sophie said about like seeing clinical patients. Lopa ma'am, like, used to tell me that you should see one patient every day in your life. So like in a year, you see like 365 patients. That means that you have covered your entire syllabus in 1 year.
Perfect.
Yeah. So moving on to Dr. Akshay, I want to share about him with our audience. Dr. Akshay, I think you did a brief stint in US. I think then you gave the entrance of JIPMER, got into ENT, and did not pursue that, and then have come back as a medical officer. And along with that, you have been doing many other things at the grassroots level, even in COVID. So would you like to share your inputs and what are the thoughts that you back?
My microphone.
Yes, we can hear you. I also want to know your thought processes.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you. Dr. Akshay, we can hear you. You can't hear
Akshay,
us?
We can hear you. Speak.
Yeah. So I went to the US during my internship for a month for an elective, just to get a hang of, you know, what kind of life or what kind of work life I'm going to undertake ahead. This was because of three major conditions: better pay, better work-life balance, and better quality of like the working culture, the work culture. It's a very important reason which I would like to point out, that work culture, better living conditions in the hostel or in the ward, the level of cleanliness, the facilities available during the working hours at the hospital is also one important reason for which doctors migrate. But after going there, I didn't find enough problems to solve. I'm actually inherently a problem solver. So I thought that there are more problems to solve in India, which is why I returned, simply for that reason. And when I came back, so I had missed a date for the NEET exam. So the only exam left to give was JIPMER. And fortunately or unfortunately, I cleared that exam and joined JIPMER for 6 months. I did my residency there for 6 months during the first term. didn't have any time to introspect on what I was doing because there was so much work in the first term. But when juniors do roll out every 6 months at JIPMER, so when I had some time to think about, I thought that I was more interested in making systems more efficient than providing individual patient care, which is why I resigned from JIPMER and finishing my bond right now, and also planning to, most of us, when we are in government colleges, we fail to realize the world outside of medicine. And I don't understand why we only see as PG, as post-graduation, the only option available after MBBS. Healthcare entrepreneurship and digital health infrastructure in India is booming. The Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has launched National Digital Health Mission and has numerous grants as well as incubators, which nurture ideas with respect to, healthcare, improving the healthcare infrastructure.
Can you share with us some of your practical experiences where you have worked at the grassroots level, even with technology?
Right. So during COVID, there were many patients who didn't get enough access to their own physicians because they were overburdened or because of travel restrictions. So what we did there was a colleague from Osmania Medical College who started a teleconsultation service. So over the course of 2 months, we helped 3,000 patients. There were 100 of doctors, a team of 100 doctors, and we helped 3,000 patients to, get appropriate medical advice. Most of them were clueless regarding what step to take because they were panicking and looking for help. So, and right now what I'm doing is more on the lines of providing chronic care management. Diabetes is a huge problem in India and needs a routine follow-up with doctors, with pharmacy, with labs, with constant monitoring is required. And that's not up to the mark is what we feel. And trying to do that, I'd like to share a few factors, a few statistics, that healthcare is a booming industry from 2014 to 20. It has shown a compound annual growth rate of 22%. And this growth is driven by lifestyle diseases, aging population, increased income level of the patients, increased access to insurance, and growing health awareness. So this puts immense pressure on the stakeholders, right? And the issue is there is no efficient management of the scarce human resources we have. And there's the infrastructure is also inadequate. So what we need to do is we need to keep a balance between controlling the cost burden on consumers as well as improving the quality of care and accessibility. So I've seen that there are many digital health startups and many healthcare organizations, which are private ones, which are run by people who have no relation with medicine. And that's actually quite absurd because we know the pain points of the system. We know where the gaps which are needed to be bridged. So I think students should also consider an option apart from post-graduation, the routine way to go it, because there are a lot of opportunities available. And in this way, you could also improve the infrastructure of our country by improving the operational efficiencies.
Yeah, it's a very nice thing that you're doing, and you're showing us by practice that even without doing post-graduation, there are so many things, so many ways in which we can contribute to improve the healthcare of a country. So the scarcity of post-graduation or the necessity, or maybe it's a prestige issue that people feel that they need to do post-graduation, that we have to remove that from our mental.
Yeah. Actually, I'll be honest, I had a really tough time with my family members, close and extended, because when I told them that I wanted to resign from post-graduation, faced up a lot of backlash, because everyone feels that if you're not a postgraduate, then you haven't made it big in life, or if you haven't moved to the US, you haven't made it big in life. But what comes intuitively to me, I'd like to follow that. So, and hopefully we'll try to bridge a lot of gaps in healthcare.
Akshay, really, I think it's really a great thing to listen from you. And I feel futuristically, if you see even the West, if you look at the John Hopkins or Howard, they have broken these walls of medicine with engineering and the other management.
Exactly, sir.
In fact. And I think in India, we are still rigid about this. Yeah. If you and in fact, in Vision 2015 document, which we had published in 2010, if you know MCI, we had put forward this concept of management degrees and double degrees and kind of thing. I think if you really see, the world has gone that way. And as you rightly said, we have to think about the other options to grow. And we should really try to expand the whole health professions market or what that area, so that it's not only, as Lani sir very rightly said, you know, we are only talking about the doctor's numbers. We have to really see the infrastructure. If the beds improve, the cleanliness of the hospital, the systems improve, the doctors will definitely will stay. No, why he will like to go?
Right.
I think so. Somebody has to work on that also. No?
I would just like to pause for a moment. I think Dr. Lane needs to leave.
Because as I'm leaving, I just like the Supya sir was saying, the infrastructure, the attraction to the doctor. I submitted the project to the government of Maharashtra. I think it may be 5 years before, when Savan sir was the minister. And that time I wrote that 3-4 talukas should be made one. At one taluka, everything should be made available to the doctor. The all talukas, they may be 30 to 40 kilometers away. As the roads are there, doctors can definitely go there. That may be in the emergency also. And they will stay in the good quarter, in a big, you can say, in the urban area. And they can serve in the rural area. So you'll have to make a hub in at one place for the doctors. And then they can provide the services in the rural. But it is not happening. Even in the rural, if they are going, they should be paid more. So their pay should be minimum twice to the doctor who are working in the urban. So that will also help. They were giving double NPA to the people who are working in the rural Maharashtra. But now the NPA has come to 3,000 rupees and practice is also not permitted. And because of that, the doctors are not getting attracted to work in the government hospital. The person who is working in the UGC, that means in the professional colleges, that is art, science, they are getting the same pay equal to the doctors. Doctors are working 24/7 and they are working 1/24. After that also, their pay and our pay is equal. So how doctor can be attracted? So that will have to change in India, the policy. The policymakers should take a note. And I think after the COVID time, definitely there will be some change. And excuse me, I'm sorry that I'm going for another appointment. Thank you very much. Thank you, Supya sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you,
nice
sir.
To see you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, taking ahead, sir has started the discussion on the ways in which we can attract or make our doctors who have gone abroad come back by giving scholarships, having incentives like extra pay, having good stay facilities. What more things that can be done at our level, at administration level, which will attract or keep our doctors back in India? So I would like to hear from each one of you, any solutions. Dr. Devi, Dr. Puneet. Yes, Dr. Akshay.
So the major issue is access of healthcare in the rural areas, right? So mostly we have PHCs in rural areas which don't attend to emergency cases, but technology has come a long way and we could easily have nurse-assisted telemedicine services, which could cater to those needs where emergency care is not required. And this reduces the burden, or not burden, but the requirement for doctors at such places. We have IoT-based devices where, you know, instantly you could get many vital parameters real-time on doctor. So doctors could get the vital parameters as well as auscultation, lung auscultation and heart auscultation sounds while seeing the patient at a distance. A thing which many doctors are apprehensive about digital consultation is they're not able to check patients. So even that issue is bridged to a great extent.
So that's a very interesting take. And I think we are, telemedicine is advancing. We just need to make it available even to the rural setups. So where we can take care of the health issues. Yes, Dr. Aditya, Dr. Puneet. We would also like your inputs for the same.
I have a slightly different different view on this. I think that we've been very critical about migration of doctors outside of India. I think we are not looking at the positives that it is doing. So I just want to point out the positives that it is doing. So, okay. So if we look at the amount of inward remittance of rupees or foreign currency that happens in India, it is the largest by far in any country. In last year, 2020, we had an inward remittance of $84 billion, which is nearly 3.1% of our GDP. In contrast, by the way, our spending on public healthcare is 1% of the GDP, and we are making 3.1% from inward remittance from people who have gone outside of India. Now, this is a significant boost to the Indian economy. It is pouring money that is not printed by the RBI. And I don't really understand a lot about the complex world of economics and finance, but I know for a fact that when there is an inward remittance, when there is money poured inside of the economy, it increases the value of the Indian rupee as compared to the other currencies like US dollar, euro, pounds, whatever. So I think we are kind of forgetting this aspect of it, the amount of money that is being poured into this. And India has, as we've all been discussing, that a big problem that India faces is lack of infrastructure. And the money that is being poured in from people who've gone outside of India can be redirected towards bettering our infrastructure. So for who knows, maybe there are a lot of new colleges that are being built today. A lot of money is required for that. Like we were paying pretty much nothing for our medical education. That was because the government was covering a massive portion of that. Where is this money coming from? This money is a part of it is from people who've gone abroad and are sending money back home back home.
I get your point. I get your point, Aditya.
No, Aditya. Yeah. I think very rightly said, I feel that's a advantage of money coming, huge amount of money coming, you know, especially, I think, as you rightly said, it's a foreign exchange comes there. In fact, there are many institutions who give back to their institutions, you know, IITs, CMC, they build so much for the hospitals. So I think it's a great advantage, no doubt about that. There's another concept called as a brain circulation. You know, it's a very interesting concept if you read into the literature. It says that the people who are going abroad are young and they're not so skilled. But by the time they go, they become very skilled. They can come back and give to the institution something back. You know, there were two concepts which were come. One was reverse brain drain, and there was a brain circulation with gain. You know, these concepts are very important. So what is reverse brain drain? I think somewhere in the 2010 to 2015, many foreigners wanted to come back and settle in India. And many engineers came from US and they started working, work from home and all. But now again, that trend is changed after 2018. You know, that is what. But brain circulation means a young professor in Harvard, like my own student now is somewhere in Harvard or John Hopkins. He can now talk with telemedicine to my college students. He can come as an adjunct professor. He can spend some amount of time to train my colleagues in India. I think that is also important gain in addition to money.
Exactly.
That skill transfer is also important. You can also try to solve problems and train people in India. I think that circulation has to start, you know, brain circulation. And that's a very great advantage of the people going abroad. So don't consider only money. Money is important, no doubt about that. But there are other ways of also benefits to the brain drain. The next point which I wanted to say, you know, I used to discuss this with the Ministry of Health about, say, 10 years ago. And their idea was, you know, they think totally differently. They feel we should produce so many doctors that we should be producers and supply to the whole world. You know, that was their way of increasing seats. But I personally feel, okay, you can do that, you know, so that they bring money back to their families and all. But I think we have to make our home also good, no? If somebody is going out. So both the thing balance has to be there. It can't be one way, you know, that's why. The biggest problem is we are producing doctors. We are not treating our infrastructure very well. We need to make our infrastructure systems very well. Then only we'll find that we train better, we send better, we gain better. You know, all the thing has to happen.
I had heard one concept from you, sir, that we produce so much that it spills over to the rural area where the need is.
That is
the concentration is less.
Yeah, that happened in Maharashtra. See, that concept has happened in Maharashtra compared to, say, Northeast or something. And that we used to call as a spillover concept. You know, if you really see, India is a very interesting country where southern states have maximum number of medical colleges and northern states have a lesser number of medical colleges. Now, a city like, a country like, say, Maharashtra. Now, Maharashtra has some 50 medical colleges. Karnataka has 55, 60 medical colleges. Now, if you look at the infrastructure, every taluka has a CT and MRI today, which is not so if you go to Uttar Pradesh and all. Now, that is why, or Himachal and all. Why? Because there are not so many doctors. When the doctor's concentration in a particular state increases, as Munira said, there's a spillover effect. And people go to the second level places, third level places to create infrastructure. And then with the help of the government, we can make a better health service. And the quality of life also improves over a period of time with internet, telemedicine. Now everybody has a good quality of life. So I think, I mean, people going out, I have no objection. There are benefits to this. But I think we need to think about solutions which will be much more than only people stopping people to go in.
So like we have the carrot and we also have the stick. So we have the bond, but we also need some more incentives like scholarships. We need better pay, better infrastructure. We need to increase our postgraduate seats to retain our students.
Can I come
and of course, yes, Dr. Puneet, more out-of-the-box solutions from you.
One thing is because I interact lots with the students, right from second year, third year. So I interact with thousands of students in my in a particular year frame from for there. So my problem is, and I completely empathize with the students, why should there be a court case every year? For a medical admission, you go back to the history, there is a court case every year, some small point seats cancelled, again, reallotment, this really pains me. This has to be done away with because it's absolutely unfair for the student. Even this year, this COVID was there, the NEET PG has been postponed 3-4 times. The student is frustrated, is preparing for the last 3 years. It really pains me. I empathize with them because every year there's a court case. You go back in the history, madam, right since when I was a student preparing for PG. I got the best of the ranks and I chose. People are telling me, why you want to take gynec when you've got the best ranks? I said, no, gynec is, I love it, so I'll take that. And even every year, there's some kind of a, this process has to be streamlined. Why should every year somebody go to a court?
This chaos is something which the students also want to move away from. Uncertainties.
See, that process is streamlined. It really would really meritorious student and of course increasing the seats is one option and infrastructure need.
No, I think you are very right, Puneet. That uncertainty and going through all these cycles makes many people want to go abroad. I think government should try to make. But see, ours is a democratic country. I cannot stop people taking away morchas and going to court and Supreme Court and. You know, it is so painful for everyone, you know, as a teacher, as an administrator, as an educator, you always feel extremely painful that the student, their NEET is blocked. You know, it's a mess. But I think because we have very openness, too much of openness, too much of democracy also problem there.
I'd also like to add that in order to retain and nurture talent, sometimes we just keep asking for things, but if we keep an open mind from the second year, most of my colleagues or most of my juniors must have started preparing for their entrance exams. But if we have an open mind, you know, rather see the bigger picture, what kind of opportunities are available. If you're ready to invest lakhs of rupees in private colleges, or if you think that you might not get the choice of your college, you want to go out or go to private colleges, why don't you want to invest that amount of money in, you know, building your own, probably a practice or an I feel that doctors are not entrepreneurial enough. You don't even have to invest your own money. There are people who give grants, there are investors, there are angel investors, there are venture capitalists.
So what I hear from you that we should have this kind of subject also in the curriculum?
Yes, why not? Strategy, innovation, and probably how to, you know, because I feel that doctors are really bad with money and have not come to a level where we could have comfortable conversations about it. And that really hampers their growth because many times they are slaves to the corporate culture of hospitals which are not at all owned by doctors. And
Devi, we have not heard from you for a long
time. Doctors are great at counting, but not at investing into stuff.
Yes, one last comment from Devi before we move on to the audience.
I just wanted to say that a lot of burden or healthcare burden is like burned by the doctors. So if we could like strengthen allied healthcare workers like EMTs, nurse practitioners, respiratory therapists, speech therapists, that we are also creating more jobs. We are also empowering doctors to like do their own work and have a bigger team to be able to care better for the patients. And that is what will really help the patients in kind of like care and also have some quality time of doctors. So
there was a lot of agitation and opposition when those bridge courses were discussed to improve the healthcare and provide the resources. So
I think that there are some uncertainties in those bridge courses. They are replacing doctors, which should not be the case. They should be adding on to what doctors are doing. And like if they are doing like surgeries, they can be surgical techs or surgical assistants and not become surgeons who are actually licensed surgeons. So something like that.
I think that basically what Devi was trying to say is empowering people like midwives who can carry out something like a normal delivery is everywhere else in the world done by a midwife, not necessarily by a doctor. A doctor is only overseeing that procedure, and probably Dr. Bhojani might be able to weigh in on this. We don't need doctors over there, but their time is being invested into that. But the problem over in this, I believe, is the hierarchy that exists in medicine, where a doctor is at the very top
also, and then everyone else is below them. Also the legal repercussions.
Yes, but I believe that people, if you're trained for that, if a midwife is trained for doing carrying out normal delivery procedures, then there should not be any legal repercussions of it. A doctor should be overseeing that procedure, not necessarily putting his or her time into that. So by empowering other allied people, I think we were empowering doctors as well. The problem with bridge courses that you mentioned was they were allowing people from different branches of medicine to practice a completely different kind of medicine altogether. People from Ayurveda or homeopathic specialists were allowed to practice allopathic medicine. That was a problem. But not allowing somebody who's trained in midwifery to practice midwifery.
See, Munira, there's a concept of physician assistant, which is very, very well known all over the world, where routine OPD visits, assisting people has already taken part of the healthcare professional efficiency. It's our culture where we want a doctor to see everything and do it. That is a thing where the doctor gets overburdened. We need to, do that. That's a very good suggestion, Devi, but it's a cultural issue rather than the actually health issue.
Sir, but that is also partially because we don't respect other people who are not doctors, right? People are not going to say that, acha, okay, you are a physician assistant and I'm going to listen to you. They're like, nahi, physician assistant doesn't understand anything. I want somebody who has an MD medicine to tell me that.
Okay, I understand. That's what I'm saying. So you have to change the minds of people.
Sir, but if we, as doctors, empower physician assistant to be able to take our place, we'll be able to tell our patients that, okay, this person is capable of taking over some of my patients, then our patients will also be listening to us. So it works both ways.
I think that would be possible in a government kind of a setting where a patient has no other option just to go ahead with the process. But in private setups, if a patient is paying for this, I'm not sure.
Yeah. See, I tell you, as a professor, many times your residents only see your patient. So even if he comes with your name in the emergency, the first year resident only sees the patient. But in a private setup, when somebody is paying a huge amount, he would expect that doctor to be there in the night also to see him, even in his emergency. Yeah. So that's a cultural issue, I'm telling you. It's not it's a minds of people have to change.
Sometimes we are promoting it. Like as doctors, we are always there for our patients. But if we say that, the physician assistant is supposed to do that job in that period of time, I'm not going to be available.
As Aditya said, that I should be able to tell patient very comfortably that I'm going to go for 3 weeks in Spain.
Yeah.
And that is my holiday which I have earned. I think that kind of a culture stays only in the West. It is not in India. India, even if you are in Ladakh, patient will phone and tell me, should I take this tablet in the morning before meal or after meal? You know, I think that's the problem with our culture. You know, he wants to listen from doctor whether I should drink it with water or tea or coffee. You know, that's the problem.
So I hear very good thoughts from each one of you. Very interesting. And yes, we can do a lot of things with the administrative help to reduce the effects of the migration of the healthcare workers. And of course, we do have a lot of benefits, as Aditya has mentioned. It's not all bad. It's good for the country, good for the brain circulation, as sir mentioned. Now I open this panel discussion for the audience to put in their questions. We already have one question in the chat. Kiran, would you like to unmute yourself and ask away the question, please? Kiran, if you are there, please unmute yourself and ask the question to the panelist. Okay, I'll read out the question that Kiran has put in the chat. It goes like this: just like IAS, IPS, IFS, do the panelists think that we need IMS services, that is the Indian Medical Services, for development of healthcare sector in India?
Absolutely. I'd like to add that most rules made for doctors regarding entrance exams or everything is decided by people who hardly have any idea about medicine. So definitely, this needs to be a norm.
Yeah, true. I think IMS is needed, but my experience is slightly different. I think when I was working in corporation, we had so many doctor administrative IAS officers, you know, almost 4 or 5, but they think like IAS only. They don't think like doctors and in favor of a doctor. So I personally feel a doctor has to understand the real grassroots problems of working in a hospital. And even if they're IAS, you know, IMS, they should work in a hospital setting throughout their career, you know. People jumping from IAS career, that is a problem. You know, once he works for 3 months, say 3 years, he works in SIDCO, then he works with engineering, railways, and then he comes to. So he's not useful. Somebody with IMS should work with the hospitals throughout his life and with doctors. Then only it will improve. You.
Okay, do the audience have any other questions for our panelists? Okay, Advait has mentioned, what about the foreign medical graduates facing discrimination in the system? Advait, do you mean about foreign medical graduates coming to India?
No.
Or going abroad?
He means in the other places in the hospital.
Yes.
Yes, there is a discrimination. Slight amount of discrimination do they face, especially in any country you go, their students are much more favored and outsiders are little never met. For example, you know, anybody who goes foreign graduates like US, UK, they are never given a consultant. Many of them remain at a staff grade. In US also, you will find they will made consultants, but they will not be made HODs. Very few go to level of HODs. So I think that discrimination remains. But one of the better part of US is that they respect talent. And they respect your quality rather than your background more. So they are, especially Northeast and California. I think if you go in the central part of the US, there is a discrimination. Mm-hmm. But if you go to US and there are corners of these two, they respect talent. So some degree of discrimination, but not much. You know, there are deeper thoughts into this, which I cannot say here. But I think you will realize this. There also is a some degree of a discrimination and hierarchy where you are not able to reach.
Thank you, sir.
I just wanted to add that it's the same as in any country. Even like if students come to India after doing their MBBS from Russia or some other country, they also have to clear an exam and like they are not very favored. So it's always like people who are in the system are always more favored than people who are coming from outside the system.
I think that's what Advait is mentioning in the chat, that he was asking about foreign medical graduates who come to India. So they complete their UG outside India, come back every year and still face discrimination in our Indian system also.
Yeah. So can I, because I train a lot of foreign medical graduates, I feel. So there are two things. I myself have traveled to Russia, China, Ukraine, and sorry to say, the Indian education is far, 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 far way superior compared to, it's not about discrimination per se. The result speaks for itself. The exam which somebody was talking about is the Foreign Medical Graduate Examination, which the government conducts. It's a very, very straightforward examination. Let me say, if an Indian student who is from AEM, KEM, anyway, if he studies for 4-5 years, he gives the exam, he would get, I'm very sure, 75, 80 on 100. The pass percentage of that examination in India is only 15. That means out of 100 students, only 15 are able to pass that exam. The reason being, because I've seen it myself in Russia, China, Ukraine, where I've been there, the student, the teachers are not up to the mark, and majority, now the things are improving. So all of them, the students are doing complete relaxation for the 4-5 years. I've seen it with my own eyes. They're very much in the only final year, they wake up and they start preparation. So it's not about discriminating anybody, but really the knowledge is very, very poor. And that speaks for itself, that when you see the FMG exam, it's hardly anything compared to the NEET PG. NEET PG is your FMG is a very simple, straightforward exam. The pass percentage is only 15 to 20. It has improved now with our coaching and all that stuff. It was initially only 5-10%. So it's where you do your basic knowledge for, if you're foundation is strong, you will get the respect. If you have wasted 3-4 years, I would say, and just relaxed, and then you come back, you compare yourself with India, you're of course lost, because the Indian students cutthroat way above all of them.
Dr. Supe, this brings me to one question, that will the foreign medical graduates wanting to practice in India will have to give the exit exam or the next?
No, see, I think 2008, Government of India, NMC, MCI and all have now accepted degrees of 5 countries straightforward. I mean, they don't ask any questions like US, UK, I think France, Australia and one more country, I think. So all these exams, if they have a degree there, for example, if I become a nephrologist in, say, America and I have a regular degree there, then I don't have to really appear for any exam in India. I have to just do that. And that is, I think, postgraduate degrees are accepted. And I think that if it's so, 5 countries, but other countries will have to appear for NEET and become postgraduates today. See, today what has happened, previously anybody used to practice anything. Now the concept of credentialing and privileging is coming in most of the places. What is my skill set and how much I am allowed to really do that? And for that, you need additional kind of registrations with MMC and IMCs. So this concept is going to grow now in every specialty also. So I think some of the degrees of 5 countries will be accepted. Others, I think, over a period of time will require some.
Thank you, sir. Shirish, you have a question. Please unmute yourself and ask. Shirish Rao, you had a question. You had raised your hand.
Yeah, ma'am. Sorry, my meeting just got shut down. I'll ask now.
Yeah.
So regarding the foreign medical undergraduates that we are speaking about, I have also heard a similar thing regarding post-graduation. Like if someone wants to pursue, many people go out to pursue some subject which is of their interest, which is not very well studied in India. Well, suppose Hopkins is the best institute to study public health, is what is considered worldwide. But if someone goes out, studies over there and comes back, I don't think, I have heard that they don't give much of a value in the core Indian public health sector, that is the government sector, to those people who have come from there and they, like, so I don't think that then it's again not serving the purpose of
Shirish, what the... Can I answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
See, I used to take interviews at Dorabji Tata and Tata Trust for all the people who wanted to go abroad. You know, and the most important is that many of the students use these health management courses as a jumping ground to go to US. You know, I think they don't get visa. They take this as to go to visa. They do 1 year of this course. And after that, they work there and then they become this. So that is one answer to you, that people don't go there seriously to learn public health management. The second issue is that public health management in USA is totally different than what Indian public health systems are. We are still struggling with many of the basic things, while US has totally different kind of a public health issues. So trying to translate knowledge from there to here, no. Skills, yes, definitely you can bring some skills, attitudes and try to apply. There are many students who have come back and tried to work in our public health setup after doing that. But I think What is important is that don't expect that once you have done a foreign degree, then you will be given a green carpet, kind of a green carpet here. No, it's not likely to happen. I think once you come back, you will also have to understand the needs of this public health sector and then work on that. I think Akshay can explain this much better according to me because he's working in the ground. But my experience about all the students expecting that we'll be given importance into public health sector just because I have done 1 year course into John Hopkins is not really going to work because it's a very different set of courses and skills you achieve with that 1 year.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. There's one question and we will take this last question. Piyush has mentioned whether MD, MS from US or UK, are they given government jobs as professors in India? So Piyush, are you interested in going, pursuing MD, MS in US, UK?
No. I think if anybody wants to answer, otherwise I'll answer because the answer is very clear. People from MD, MS from 5 countries are allowed to practice. To become a teacher, they have to have teacher's experience and they have to go through a hierarchy. They have to take a special permission from the NMC or DNB to become a teacher. It doesn't happen directly.
Thank you so much, sir. And thank you all the panelists, Dr. Akshay, Dr. Aditya, Dr. Puneet, Dr. Devi, and especially a great thanks to Dr. Supay for adding all these dimensions to this topic of brain drain and the repercussions and the possible solutions. Thank you so much. And over to Vidushi Gupta for the further vote of thanks and mention about the feedback.
So with this, we come to the end of our amazing panel discussion. We sure came up with ideas and opinions regarding brain drain from the point of view of various stakeholders, that is medical educators, practicing doctors, health administrator and Indian students pursuing further studies abroad. Hopefully, the solution suggested would be implemented such that minimum loss is incurred to the donor country and maximum global benefit is achieved. I would like to thank the panelists for taking out time and joining us for this discussion. Your presence made this event a grand success. I would like to thank Dr. Munira ma'am for moderating the session and bringing the best out of the discussion. I would also like to thank the audience whose participation made this event even more interesting. I would like to request the audience to please fill a feedback form which would be provided after you leave the meeting so that you can get your certificate of attendance. Finally, I would like to thank the entire team of Conference 2021 for making this event possible. Thank you all.
It was such a pleasure to see all of you. I mean, Devishi and all of you. I think after a long time I saw you, I really feel happy. And I feel Confluence is going great ways from national to international. All the best. And I'm really proud of you, all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you
for having me here. And it was great to share the stage with all of you. Thank you. Thank you, Munir, and thank you, all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Puneet.
Thank you, dear panelists.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.